We're here at World Time Attack with Darren, who's running this Evo 7 behind me in the open class. And we wanted to get a little bit of insight from Darren as to what goes on when you're building a car at this level. So, Darren, the reason we wanted to chat to you is a lot of this car, you've sort of been involved heavily with the build yourself rather than just taking it to a workshop with a big old pot of cash and saying, here, build me a race car. To start with, let's get a bit of a high-level overview of the car and what's been done to it. So let's start with the engine package. What's in it?
It's a Nitto 2.2 litre. Structure 2.2, Kelfod Cams, a lot of the other standard trimmings, ARP, 625 bolts, things like that, metal head gasket.
What sort of power level and boost level are you running in it? Because really that's kind of what drives the selection of your engine package.
Yeah, so we're probably pretty modest on the boost level, about 33, 34 pound at the moment.
And what's that give you in terms of power?
We're looking about 500 kilowatts at the hubs.
Okay, so the rest of that obviously comes down to drivetrain to get that to the track reliably. What have you got there in the way of a gearbox?
We've got a six-speed sequential. Six-speed flat shifting, auto blip on the downshift as well.
Electronics package in the car, what's actually controlling everything?
We've got M-tron KV8 for the ECU, MoTeC PDM, MoTeC C127 dash, an M-tron can expander for things like shock pots and additional sensors throughout the car.
So pretty typical open class build, very high spec, lots of power, lots of aero, lots of downforce. One of the reasons I wanted to pin you down for a bit of a chat here is you have actually taken a few of High Performance Academy's courses, and I'm interested to learn how you've actually put that knowledge to use with this car. So for a start, can you tell us what courses you actually have taken?
So I've taken the engine fundamentals course, as well as the electronics, or the wiring fundamentals. The engine, I wanted to be able to understand and speak the same language to the engine builders and you know, not just go there and say, hey, build me an engine, actually understand what's happening, you know, help with part selection and all that sort of thing.
So let's talk about how that panned out. What did you learn from that course that helped drive the parts you selected, and how did the dealings go then with the shop that actually built the engine?
Yeah, I think it helped a lot because you could really look at where you need to spend the money and spend it in the right places.
Yeah.
And also try to spend it once, you know, poor man pays twice. So, look, a lot of that went in, had a lot of conversations with the engine builders, and then, yeah, came up with this sort of package.
I think your point there is something that is so often missed, is that I quite often see people wasting money on parts that aren't needed at the power and RPM levels they're going to. So, you know, if you've got an unlimited budget, well, obviously that doesn't matter, but not too many of us do. So actually selecting the parts that are suited for your power application is so important. I'm interested with, obviously, the 4G63 in particular. There's a variety of different engine capacity options, 2 litre, 2.4, 2.3, and the 2.2. Why did you go to the 2.2?
So we went with the 2.2 because I think that's been tried and proven for Time Attack. You know, the top open class Evo, the pro class Evo of Tilt and Evo, they, you know, all run 2.2. So, you know, why reinvent the wheel? I think, yeah, that was a good decision to go with it.
In terms of the wiring, you did the wiring course, but you actually haven't wired the car yourself. But that was still, again, just like the engine building course, helpful to you when you were working through that process and designing it. So talk us through that. How did you use that course?
Yeah, so I actually started with the intent to do it myself, but I wanted I didn't have the experience in building it, but I had the knowledge at that point, and I really wanted a well-polished product at the end of it for ultimate reliability and the satisfaction behind a big project like that. But what I took from the course is being able to decide on sensors, what hardware I needed, and what sort of inputs and where the sensors would be wired to, all of that sort of thing I did myself and did all of the documentation, pinouts, diagrams, all that sort of thing, and then took that to a professional motorsport wiring shop, and then they took all that information and, you know, made a few changes that they would recommend here and there, and then built the harness off that.
But I'm guessing that sounds like similar to the engine. It allowed you to sort of get a head start, making sure that you got the results that you wanted without, again, needlessly wasting money on sensors or wiring that wasn't essential. plus that documentation. I think this is one of those points that's so often overlooked. Again, even with those who are doing this professionally, it's very easy to just sort of jump in with a couple of rolls of wire, some side cutters, and actually get stuck in making the harness. But you know, when you come back to it in 6 months or 12 months time and you need to make a change or maybe fault find a problem, that documentation, it's so critical, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we've got additional pinouts throughout the car for things that we planned for, and we've sort of added those, like tire temp sensors, shock potentiometers, and then, you know, you know all of the stuff when you're building it, but fast forward 12 months, we had spreadsheets to go back to, and then instantly know what does what goes where, and, you know, adding additional things is, you know, a very, very straightforward process.
So tell us about the configuration. I mean, I know you didn't tune the engine yourself, but there's a lot that goes on before you can even fire a car up like this for the first time, particularly with the PDM or power distribution management system. You've got to program that as well, the dash, communications between the ECU dash PDM. How did you go about that? How did you find that process? How difficult is it?
It's actually not that difficult. When you read the documentation from the manufacturers, you know, I watched a lot of the gold webinars, and there's a lot of good info in there. So a lot of that I took in and did all of the PDM configuration myself. I mean, starting with the basics, you know, getting the ignition to turn on, then, you know, giving power to coils and, you know, all the other ancillaries across the car, and then started to play with a little bit more advanced functions, you know, start, stop buttons, auto start, all that sort of thing. And then on the ECU side, just configuring all the sensors. So, you know, looking at the data sheet, what's 0.5 volts relate to a pressure, like just configuring all that stuff. So when the tuner sits down, that's all ready to go for him, and he can start doing all the important bits.
So therefore, that should in theory make the tuner's job easier. When the tuner's job's easier, it's going to make the whole tuning process quicker, and that obviously results in a smaller bill at the end of the day.
Yeah, exactly. And that was a huge driver, and not just cost saving. I mean, I like to tinker and play around and you know, learn a lot along the way, and try and be as hands-on as possible. But yeah, ultimately, it saved a lot of money.
Let's get on to actually getting the best performance out of the car. I mean, there's a lot of things going on, and you've got a lot of adjustability in the car between suspension, you know, power delivery, everything that goes into it. How are you using the data analysis or the data logging to kind of find out where there's potential to improve either the chassis or potentially your own driving?
So I'm using a lot of, I would say I'm using the basics. So your throttle position, brake pressures, steering angle, you know, your speed, all that sort of thing. But then also looking at the variance plot, you know, where are you losing time? Where are you gaining time?
Let's talk about that variance plot. For those who aren't aware of what that is, what is the variance channel? What does that mean?
So you can use or compare a lap to another lap, and that gives you an idea of where your the comparison lap, you're either gaining time or losing time, and then you can look at whether you're coming in too hot or you're braking too much. So you can really get a lot of information out of that.
So essentially it's showing where you're up or where you're down compared to the reference lap, and then you can dive into that particular area of the track in a little bit more detail to really figure out exactly why you're up or down. So there's a couple of ways we can use this. We can obviously use this against our own benchmark lap, but as amateur drivers, often it's also beneficial to stick a pro driver in the car for a few laps and see where they're faster or slower. Is that something you've done?
Yeah, definitely. That's something I've done a couple of times, and that's really helped with chassis development, as well as my own personal driving development. We've made a lot of changes based on their feedback, and I've been able to take a lot of different bits of information throughout, you know, how they're driving different corners, and all that sort of thing. So it's been very helpful.
Another element with data analysis, and I'm guilty of this myself, I love data, I love sensors, and you know, it can be very tempting to just go and throw more and more sensors on the car. But particularly when we're new to data analysis, sometimes less is actually more. Do you find that just focusing on a few key parameters, at least initially, helps you sort of filter out the noise, essentially.
Yeah, definitely. Like I said, those key elements around throttle, brake, steering, and speed, that's where you start. I mean, for most of the event, that's really what I'm looking at. And then you start looking at things that we've got on this car, like tire temp and shock data, and that's really giving us an idea of which direction to go. But yeah, it's very easy. I mean, I'm also a data nerd. I've got many sheets and workbooks in i2, and yeah, it's very easy to get lost.
I think as well, for those who aren't aware, i2, you're talking here about MoTeC's data analysis software, and you can set that up, as you mentioned, with specific worksheets or workbooks for a particular element that you want to dive into. So setting that up beforehand, because obviously a race weekend is busy, you don't have a lot of time, so you want that set up so once you've downloaded that data, you can quickly find the data that you want and zero in on that. Another element I wanted to talk about is with the Mitsubishi platform, these later model cars, you've got an adjustable or active center differential, which is computer controlled. You're doing this, as I understand, through the M-tron. So can you talk to us about how that works and how instrumental that is in improving the handling and balance of the car?
Yeah, definitely. So we went down the path of using the M-tron to do the differential control. We didn't use a standalone diff controller. Essentially, that's just working off the wheel speeds, some inputs and outputs to the hydraulic pump, as well as the solenoid to control the pressure to the actual clutch plates.
What are the inputs then that you can use to define how much rear drive? Because this is essentially primarily a front wheel drive platform with drive being transferred to the rear by that active center differential. So what are the inputs that are controlling how much rear drive is being distributed?
Yeah, so we've got a few tables and things that we can play with, primarily throttle application coming out of corners and the way that the fronts and rears lock together on corner exit, as well as braking stability. So locking the fronts and rears together for ultimate braking stability, and then offsetting that with steering angle. So when you start entering the corner, really opening it up for that turn in.
So can you talk us through maybe what this looks like if you've got the settings really out of the ballpark compared to when you've got it really dialed and everything's working properly? What's the downsides when it's wrong?
So when it's wrong, especially through the slower corners where you're jumping on the throttle and giving it all the beans, the car will start to hop around. It's basically just the whole thing is just bound up. And we've just got very poor drive out of the corner, and it'll start hopping around and bouncing, and it's quite violent in the car.
How long does it take to get these maps dialed in? Is it a really big job, or do you sort of have some base maps that at least get you into the ballpark so it's fine-tuning?
I think it's been a long process, definitely. A lot of probably black art's gone into it a little bit, working with the chassis engineers to ultimately get the electronics of the diff controller and the chassis to work together, rather than one trying to mask the problems of the other.
All right, look, Darren, thanks for giving us your time today. It is an amazing car. Great to hear how you've actually put some of HPA's lessons to use, and all the best for the rest of your weekend here at World Time Attack.
Thanks a lot.
like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.